Yeah, there's my self-portrait. Yeah, people are sort of surprised sometimes that I'm three-dimensional. Take an imaginary average lot. Let's imagine that this lot kind of has an appropriate similar fraction of all the US's resources. You can only have the energy that's flowing through your plot of land. So you've got this column of space and you can harvest the energy that's coming from there. One of the main potential sources is that there's stuff growing there. Plants are sort of like solar panels. They grow on the ground. The sun falls on them and they convert that energy into a stored form, which we can then release by, for example, harvesting them and burning them. If you took your lot here and you just planted a lot of trees on it, here are all these trees. And so I looked up like, what's the productivity of burning wood for fuel? You come up with 38 watts. So the average house, on average, you draw about a kilowatt of power. The trees are not going to supply you with that. At best, you could use this to continuously run maybe your laptop. There's the power that's flowing through the air over your house that you can take advantage of. One of the most popular ways to do this is with solar power. The way you place the solar panels does affect their efficiency. So instead of laying the solar panels on the ground, you can tilt them up. In fact, if you want to really optimize your efficiency, you could fill the entire lot with a tilted panel. It would also mean that you would live a life of darkness, and also whoever lived to your north would live a life of darkness most of the time as they were in the shadow of your solar panel. And for most houses, they don't even need to cover their whole roof in solar panels to get enough power to power their house. If you did cover this this suburban lot with solar power, then you would be able to generate like enough power for not just you, but for like half dozen of your neighbors. Sunlight isn't the only kind of power that's flowing through the space above your home. There's also the air that's moving through, and you can harvest some of that kinetic energy using wind turbines. So if you have sort of a typical situation above your house, the wind will be much stronger the higher up you go. So this will now really depend on how your neighbors feel. You know, probably if you want to build a 200 meter wind turbine, it'll be a lot more expensive, and also you'll probably get some calls from the local zoning board. You know, in this typical area, a wind turbine that's the size of your entire yard would be capable of generating a couple dozen kilowatts of power averaged across the year. That's enough to power your house and a dozen of your neighbors. I think this might be the single worst idea in my entire book. The idea is that you can draw power from anything that's moving. And tectonic plates are moving. Tectonic plates are moving, you know, inches per year or per decade. But they're moving with a lot of force. And energy is force times distance. So you've got a really, really, really tiny distance that the plate moves, but it moves with a lot of force. And that together, that kind of adds up. So I laid out an idea. If you lived near the boundary between two tectonic plates, you could anchor a device. You have two pistons where one of them is anchored to one tectonic plate and the other one is anchored to the other tectonic plate. And they come together and they compress some kind of working fluid. As the pressure increases, you can let out the pressure by having it run a turbine. And the pressure builds up very, very slowly, but it can build up extremely high. If you manage to have pistons that are like the width of your entire lot and maybe twice as high, you could in principle generate enough power to keep your house powered over time. The catch is that tectonic plates don't have a sharp border. So if you want to anchor these pistons to the plate, you'd have to anchor them way out, spreading out the force across the plate. So if you stretch out miles away, you're going to need miles and miles of whatever this high strength steel you're using is, that's as wide as your house. And I worked out that the steel would cost on the order of $40 billion. That's $40 billion that you pay up front. But then you don't have to pay your power bill. And after the first 36 million years, you're making money. Solar and wind both do stack up pretty well. There are a couple of these fossil fuels where you could power your house for a little while based on what's available in this little plot of land, but not forever. You know, it would be more like a matter of years if you were going to take your land's fair share. Whereas the sun and the wind, there's more like enough of those for everybody, and they're going to stick around for longer. And so they seem like the better bet for the future.